So in the last class, we were trying to talk about setting out simple curves. So in the process, we said we are going to have broadly two different types of methods for setting out your simple curves. One is by linear method and other is by angular or instrumental method. That's what we have talked about. So typically in the case of linear method, we said we are going to be using simple chain and tape for setting out the curves in the case of linear method. And when it comes to the case of angular or instrumental methods, as itself mentioned, so we are going to be making use of a theodolite with or without a chain for setting out that particular simple curves. Okay. So as mentioned towards the end of the discussion in the last class, so before we start talking about either the linear method or by angular methods by which you are going to be setting out your simple curves, so we are required to understand some information regarding the layout of that particular simple curve which you are going to be setting. Layout is nothing but the plan, what is available to you with regard to that particular curve which is to be set. Okay, now why is this setting out simple curve or setting out the other curves is something very important for us? Is it not so simple for us to set out a curve in the field? So setting out the curve is not just as simple as what we think, just representing a straight line. Because the curve, once we start talking about, it has got some curvature, it has got some radius. So when you are required to set a curve of some required length, so you cannot put a chain or a tape in that curved shape and you cannot mark your length as per what you have in your plan. So that's the reason why. So it is certainly important for us to understand how that particular simple curve is to be set by following some standard procedures. Okay, so we have got different methods, either under linear methods or either under angular methods. We have got different methods by which we are going to be setting out the curves. So before we start talking about those particular methods, okay, as of the course is concerned, we are not going to be going through all those different linear methods and angular methods. So at least one of that method we'll cover in linear methods, one of such method in angular methods we'll be touching upon, just to give you an idea like how those setting out of simple curves is done in the field. Okay, before we go ahead in exactly understanding those methods, let us first have some basic idea of the information related to your curve, and then whatever that curve which we had in the plan with us, okay, that particular curve which we had in the plan in a layout, how it has to be represented, how it has to be transferred and set in the field is what we need to understand. So before we go ahead further, so there, as I told you, like irrespective of what method we adopt, so it doesn't matter. So we have got some certain important points to be understood from the layout of that particular curve which are supposed to be setting out in the field. Okay, so earlier when we were trying to talk about the simple curve, I hope you remember the shape of that simple curve. This is how your simple curve was looking like. Okay, this is a curvature of the curve, and this is the angle what is getting subtended at the center of the curve. Let's say the center is O, and we said, okay, this is one tangential line, and this is, okay, assume these are tangential lines. Bear with my drawing. Okay, if I am correct, I used the notation A, B, and this point B further extended to B dash. The angle what is getting subtended between the forward tangent, what is my forward tangent? Forward tangent is BC tangent, and rear tangent is nothing but your AB tangent. So angle subtended by with your forward tangent by the rear tangent, so that angle is nothing but this angle. So we said this is nothing but deflection angle, and the angle existing between two tangents at the point of intersection, so this angle we represented as I. So to that of the extent, some points whatever we have talked about, and this first point of tangent is what is indicated as T1, second point of tangent what is indicated as T2, and then we went on to understand what is my long chord. Long chord is nothing but the line going from point T1 to T2. So that is what we called as long chord. And we have also talked about your apex distance, and we have talked about your mid-ordinate distance. These are some of those important parameters or elements of the simple curve which we have talked about. And this is nothing but which indicates you the radius of that particular simple curve. Okay. So with this information, now let's understand what are the steps that we need to follow first in knowing about the layout of that particular simple curve. Then after understanding the information regarding that particular layout of the simple curve, then we go on to the field to set out that particular simple curve in the field. Okay. In the ultimate alignment of your road, or in the alignment of your canal, or in the alignment of your railway track or whatever it is. So we can go on to execute that work in the field. So let's look at the procedure, what we need to first basically have an idea before we go on by whatever the approach it could be to set out your curve. So after fixing the direction of your straight lines in the sense, the straights are your tangent lines, whatever we are talking about. Once we know what are the directions of your tangent lines or the direction of your straight lines from your plan, then we are going to be representing those. First, we go on to represent that straight lines AB and BC. So wherever those two straight lines intersect, so the angle of intersection between those two straight lines, which are nothing but your tangential lines, is what we are going to be calculating with the help of a theodolite. Let's say, for example, I have a theodolite which I am setting at point B, and I'll start bisecting the line BA to find out what is the angle made by your BC line with your BA. So that angle of intersection with the help of theodolite, which we simply call it as the horizontal angle between those two lines BA and BC, is what I am trying to find out. So angle of intersection is what I am trying to find out. Once the angle of intersection is known, then next subsequently we know that this extension of point B is what I can write it as B dash, and this angle is what we call it as your deflection angle, which is indicated by the notation phi. And what will be this phi value equal to? Phi value is nothing but 180 minus the angle of intersection. Okay, so once I know with the help of the theodolite what is the angle of intersection, then I can simply go on to calculate what is your angle of deflection. Okay, so once the angle of deflection is known, next step what we are going to be working out is with where is my first tangent point and your second tangent point. So first tangent point might be somewhere here, let's say T1 point. Another tangent point T2 might be somewhere here. So in between this point T1 to T2, you are supposed to be having your curve, simple curve, which has got some radius. Okay, so the radius of that simple curve is R, and the center of that simple curve is at some point O. The angle what is getting subtended between the arc of that circle or the arc corresponding to that simple curve, so the angle what is getting subtended there is what we call it as your deflection angle. Already we have seen how to calculate the deflection angle phi value, where phi value is nothing but 180 minus I, where I indicates your angle of intersection. Okay. So next our step is to understand where is this point T1 is going to be, where is this point T2 is going to be on that straight line or so-called tangential line to that respective curve which we are going to be indicating. So where is your point T1 and where is your point T2? The position of point T1 and T2 is what we are required to be finding out next step. So if point T1 and T2 are to be found, then how do I calculate point T1 and point T2? So let us first understand what does the distance from point T1 to B or T2 to B indicate. The distance from T1 to B or T2 to B indicates you what is called as tangent length. If you can recall what we have discussed in the elements of your simple curve. So that T1 to B distance or T2 to B distance is nothing but we have called it as tangent length. And we know from what we have discussed in the last class, the tangent length is nothing but we can calculate as R into tan y by 2, where R indicates the radius of your curve, simple curve, and phi indicates the angle of deflection which you have at the center of your curve. Right, so the tangent length from this particular expression, I say I can go on to find out. Once the tangent length is known from the point of intersection B, I'll measure that tangent length along this straight line. I'll measure that tangent length, and with respect to that tangent length, which is equal to r tan phi by 2, I locate the position of your T1 point. In the similar way, from point B, that is your point of intersection, again in the direction of your line BC, I'll mark the distance along that line BC, which where that length along that line BC, what I am marking is r tan phi by 2, that for that distance from point B, I am going to be marking another point on that line BC, which that point I am calling it as T2 point. So till now what I have understood is, for that respective straight lines, I understood what is your point of intersection. I have calculated your angle of intersection, and then when we have calculated your angle of deflection, and after knowing the angle of deflection, then we went on to calculate the position of your tangential points T1 and T2. So how are we calculating T1 and T2? From the point of intersection, that is from point B, your T1 point is going to be there at a tangential distance from B to A, which is equal to r tan phi by 2. And similar way, your tangential point T2 is going to be there at a distance of tangential length, which is equal to r tan phi by 2 from point B to point C. So accordingly, we are marking the position of tangential points T1 and T2. Okay, once the tangential points T1 and T2 are known, then next step. Yeah, so after locating the positions of your tangent points T1 and T2, their chain edges may be determined. What does this word chain edges mean? Chain edge is nothing but at what length, I repeat, at what length from the initial point of your straight line what you have represented. Let's say, for example, let me take an empty page. Yeah. So let's say this is my starting point from where I know my distances, what I am stretching out in that straight line direction. This is, let's say, point A. Your point of intersection I have got here. Let's say this point B. So I know what is the chain edge of that line AB. And similarly, the chain edge of the other line B2C is also known, but we are not going to be looking at the chain edge of the BC line. What we are first focusing on is the chain edge of your AB line. Now, what I understood is, after knowing the position of your tangential point T1 and locating the position of tangential point T2 corresponding to your simple curve, this is that simple curve what we are talking about, which has got some center here, having the radius r. This angle is phi. Okay. So now what is that we are saying? My objective is to understand where is that point T1? At what distance that point T1 is there? Generally, that distance is the term what we otherwise also call it as chain edge. Chain edge is nothing but at what length along that chain what you have represented, you have the position of your point T1 and subsequently the position of point T2. So if I want to know the chain edge of point T1, okay, chain edge of point T1 is nothing but it is equal to, if I know what is the chain edge of point B, what is this word chain edge of point B means? At what distance point B is existing? Okay, so once I know the chain edge of point B, from that chain edge of point B, I'll subtract the length of tangent BT1. Okay, or the other way I can say, it's the tangent length is what I am trying to subtract from the chain edge value of your point B. So once I subtract the tangent length of your B2T1, so then I can get what is the chain edge of your point T1. So similarly, if I want to calculate what is the chain edge of point T2, chain edge in the sense from the reference starting point of your data plan or map or layout, what is available with you. So at what distance point T2 is going to be there. So point T2, that's nothing but, which is what we are calling it as chain edge of point T2, is nothing but it is equal to chain edge of point T1 plus. So if I know at what distance this point T1 is there from the starting of that straight lines, change of point T1 plus length of the arc. So if I know what is the length of the arc, how do we calculate the length of the arc? Arc length, otherwise. So arc length is what I can write it as R into phi. In terms of if phi is not in radians, if phi is to be substituted in angle, then I can substitute it as, I can rewrite it as R into phi by 180 degrees. This is what we have already seen. So I'll try to calculate what is the arc length of that particular curve. And once the arc length of that particular curve is known, and if I add it to the chainage of your point T1, then from that I can go on to get what is the chainage of your point T2. Okay. So for now, what I have understood is chainage of point T1 calculated, chainage of point T2 is calculated. And this is that so-called long chord what we were trying to talk about. This is your chord. This is the arc of the curve, what we are referring to. Okay. So our next step, after knowing the chainages, what is our next step that we are supposed to be dealing with? Next step is, along this arc of the curve, along that arc of that portion of the curve, going from T1 to T2, that means, along that T1 to T2, in the field, it is important for us to mark the position of the curve in the field. So in order to mark the position of the curve in the field, you cannot just directly go to the field and put a chain or tape and say, okay, this is how the curve alignment has to be coming out. Okay, that's not possible. It's not possible so simple for us to go set a tape or chain directly from point T1 to T2 and say, this is my arc of the simple curve. That's not correct. So what we do is, we first go on to mark some points on this arc of the circle or on the simple curve. We go on to mark some points. Now, what are those points? How those points are to be marked on that particular arc? So first point, what you are going to be marking, let's say this is some point A, this is some point B, points is small points, small A, B, C, D, what I'm referring to, point small D, small E, small F, and so on. Okay. So now let's quickly understand. From point T1, that's first tangential point. This T1 point is otherwise also called as PC. This is nothing but point of curvature. It is that point where the curvature of the curve is getting started. And T2 point is otherwise also called as PT. T2 point is otherwise also called as PT. What does PT indicates means? Point of tangency. So at the end of that curve, from that particular point, your tangential line is getting started. So that is what is called as point of tangency. Yeah. So from point T1, already we know what is the chainage of point T1. I repeat, we know what is the chainage of point T1. Let's say the chainage of point T1, which I have calculated, I am getting it to be some 152 meters. I'm just roughly mentioning, okay, 152 point something or something like that. I have got chainage of T1. Let's say it is 152 meters is what is the chainage of point T1. Okay. So now here, I'm not directly understanding it as 152 meters. Rather, I'm trying to understand in terms of the number of chainages or number of times that you have spread your chain to move from point A to point T1. I repeat, number of times you have spread your chain, because standard chain will be of length 20 meters or 30 meters. Let's say, for example, I am using a 20 meter standard chain. So in order to say the chainage of point T1 is equal to 152 meters, how many times I have spread my chain from point A to point T1? So I'll start spreading my chain starting from point A. I'll align the ranging of that straight line going from A to B. And to reach the point T1, my distance from A to T1 should be 152 meters. In the sense, so if I want to reach 152 meters, first to 20 meters, next to 20 meters, next to 20 meters, next to 20 meters, 80 is completed, 100, 120, 140, and 140 meters point, could be before T1. And another chain edge of 20 meters, if you add, that will be beyond T1. Because point T1 is somewhere in between 140 meters to 160 meters. So from 140 till T1, the distance is only 12 meters. Okay. So how much length of that next chain is used to mark your point T1 is only 12 meters. Then the remaining 8 meters, let's say this is the remaining 8 meters what I am looking at. From T1 towards your point B, another remaining 8 meters is what I have not used to calculate your chain edge of point T1. I have used 7 times full chain, which gives me 140 meters plus 12 meters only from that full chain to reach to your point T1. So that's how I have said the chain edge of point T1 is nothing but it is equal to 7 times of my standard length which I have used for that chain. So 7 into 20 meters, let's say I have used 20 meters length of standard chain plus additional 12 meters is giving me the chain edge of your point T1, that is nothing but 152 meters. Okay, once the chain edge of point T1 is known, that's 152 meters. The remaining 8 meters, whatever you are looking at in the remaining portion of that chain, which is spread beyond that point T1. So that 8 meters of length, I repeat, that 8 meters of length, I'll try to mark a point on that curve. Okay, now come back to that curve, arc of that simple curve, what I am talking about. Now, on that particular arc of the simple curve, mark point A with the help of a peg. Just take some wooden peg or an arrow, just place it. It's not directly in the field. I'm now first looking at the layout. From the layout, I understand all the information. And after understanding all the information from the layout, I go on to execute the same thing in the field by marking those respective positions of small a, small b, small c, small d, small e, small f points, whatever I have represented in this figure. So those points I'll mark it in the field, and then we go on to represent what is called as your simple arc. Okay, so now this is whatever I'm trying to talk about is in the same layout or in the plan, whatever I look at. So on that plan, let's say I'm trying to mark some point on that simple curve, where that point is at a distance of 8 meters from your T1. From your point of curvature, that's nothing but from point T1. That's the first tangential point. So from that first tangential point, go on to fix a point on that arc of the simple curve at a distance of 8 meters. So that distance, whatever I am supposed to be representing 8 meters, it's not actually the arc length of 8 meters, because in the field, it's not possible for us to set exactly a curve of 8 meters length. So what we simply say is this point T1 to point A, though it was supposed to be an arc like this. Look at here what I am representing, T1 to point A, though it was supposed to be an arc, but in simple terms, I am representing it like this as a chord. Sir, earlier you talked about some chord. Now, what is this chord? The earlier chord is said to be the long chord, and this chord is some other chord. I'll try to call that particular chord as subchord. Okay. So, where the length of that point T1 to A, which I am going to be setting it as a straight line, so that length is 8 meters. Sir, you are supposed to be setting 8 meters on the arc of that curve, but you are saying that straight distance from T1 to A is 8 meters. See, the angle what is getting subtended with respect to this arc at the center of that curve is relatively small. So when the angle what is getting subtended at the center of that simple curve is small, then for that smaller angle what is getting subtended at the center, whether the arc length you are looking at or your curve length you are looking at, whether you are looking at your chord length or arc length, they are going to be more or less the same. There will be a small variation in the value, but however, we assume that as the angle what is getting subtended at the center of the circle is small, center of your simple curve is small. So whether you call it as chord length or whether you call it as your arc length, both are one and the same between your point T1 to A, small a. Okay. So next, what I am going to be doing is, I am going to mark another point on your curve. Small a point, I understood. Okay. Small b point is what I am going to mark on the curve. Now, at what distance this small b point is going to be marked on the curve means? Okay, let me continue this way. The point B is marked somewhere here. Okay, this is the point B what I am talking about. So here, as I said, I am using a chain of standard length 20 meters. So now another chain edge of 20 meters is what I am going to be stretching from small a point to mark another point small b along that arc of that simple curve. And this additional chain edge of 20 meters, what I am going to be stretching from here to here, is not once again along the arc of that curve, rather it is going to be along the straight distance from point A to point B. Okay. So if I say once again, this is my small point A, this is my small point B, the distance between this small point A to small point B is 20 meters. So next pegs, what I am going to be placing, are at the standard chain edge lengths. Earlier, from T1 to A, the length was only 8 meters, not 20 meters. Why it was only 8 meters? Because in the earlier chain, whatever I have used, I had a remaining portion of that 8 meters. So that remaining portion of 8 meters is marked on the arc of the curve. So to say, that is my first chord, indicating the arc of that particular simple curve. And the second chord, third chord, fourth chord, and so on, I am going to be marking with the same standard length of 20 meters. Okay. So for that standard length of 20 meters, this is my chord, let's say, another 20 meters, another 20 meters, another 20 meters, another 20 meters. Okay. So 8 meters gone, 20, 20, 20, 20, 20. And then the remaining here from small point F to T2, that is your second tangent point or your point of tangency. If when I'm trying to stretch my chain again, the distance what I am hardly getting is, let's say, is only some 12.2 meters. I'm not using the full chain. I'm using only a portion of the full chain. Okay. So this chord what you have represented from small f to capital T2, this is once again called as a subchord. Earlier also I represented some other subchord, T1 to small a is also, I have called it as subchord. And whatever all the other chords, A to B, B to C, C to D, D to E, E to F, these are nothing but, these chords are called as normal chords. Why, what is the difference between these subchords and normal chords? Normal chords are corresponding to a standard length of the tape, and subchords are not corresponding to the length of standard length of the tape or chain. So it is something less than that of your standard length of that particular chain or tape. Okay, so that's the reason why those particular chords, whatever are existing at the starting of your arc of the curve and ending of the arc of the curve, so those two chords are called as your subchords, and all the other intermediate chords what you are representing are what is called as your normal chords. Okay, so now after understanding some information about this particular chords, how we are marking, let me once again draw that sketch again. Okay, this is the center with angle phi, the radius of that curve what I am setting out, whatever I am looking at in the layout is this. These are your points of tangents. Okay, my tangency point is somewhere beyond, which I could not represent here. But our main focus is to understand some things here. Okay, T1 point, point A, point B, point C, point D, point E, point F, and this is our T2 point. Okay, this is also your long chord. Okay, so T1 to T2 is nothing but it is indicating you the long chord, and the other chords I have talked about, let's say chord going from T1 to A, and subsequently chord going from F to T2. T1 to A and F to T2, they are nothing, they are called as sub chords, and whereas all the other chords AB, BC, CD, DE, EF, these are all called as your normal chords. Right. So I'm just indicating all those chords. Now for that portion of the chord, or for that portion of the small arc of that curve, you will see certain angle which is getting subtended at the center of your simple curve. So let's say this angle is something what you are having it here. So I am calling this angle to be something to delta 1, let's say. Why are you using 2 notation? Why are we writing it as 2 delta 1? Okay, I'll try to talk about it later. And similarly, for this portion of the arc of the curve going from A to B, or for that arc chord which is indicated between point A to B, the angle what is subtended at the center. See, I'm focusing more here only. Later on, I'll not be spending this much time. So this I am indicating it as, let's say, 2 delta 2. And similarly for all the other the angles what are getting subtended, this is 2 delta 3. Likewise, I have other n number of cases if I am looking at. So this last one, let's say it is 2 delta n. Likewise, I have got n number of angles, smaller angles corresponding to n number of chords. So the angles what I have represented. Okay, so starting with 2 delta 1, ending with 2 delta n. Now look at here at the corresponding point of curvature, that is point T1, tangential point T1. T1 towards, this is your towards your point B, and T2 towards your point B. You have your straight lines getting intersected at the point B above the picture what I have shown you here. The tangent, if you look at here, from the tangential line T1B to your first chord, the sub chord what is indicated going from T1 to small a. Okay, so this angle is nothing but it is delta 1. And similarly, from the tangential line T1 to B, if I am looking at what angle of inclination this second chord going from A to B is existing. So if I want to understand that, so what I will try to do here is, okay, just look at here. I'm just extending my first chord, T1 to small a chord. I'm just trying to extend it only for our idea. And at this point A, I'm trying to draw a tangent to the portion of your arc of the curve. At point A position, I'm just trying to draw a tangent. See, whatever I'm now talking about is everything represented step by step in your procedure, whatever I have indicated in your slides. Not to worry, what is that I'm talking about? Okay, so from the chord, the tangent, if you look at here, tangent to the curve, this chord is corresponding to the chord referring to the point going from T1 to small a. So from that chord to a tangent to the curve, what is the angle of inclination? The angle of inclination what we had was delta 1. Okay, now from this tangent line, again, let us understand, how did we start? From the tangent line, the chord is at an inclination of something delta. Now here also in the same way, from the tangent line which is indicated at point A to your second chord, which is my second chord going from small a to small b. the angle of inclination, this angle of inclination, I'm just extending the second chord for my idea. This angle of inclination is nothing but we are writing it as delta 2. Okay, and in the similar way for the other stretch of the portion, the second chord I'm just trying to extend it for my understanding. From at point B, I'm just trying to draw a tangent to the portion of your arc of the curve. What is this angle? This is nothing but delta 2. It should be delta 2. And once again, from the tangent which is drawn from point B to your third chord, what should be that angle of inclination? This angle of inclination should be equal to delta 3. And likewise for the rest part of the curve. Okay. And in terms of the deflection angle also, I can just try to indicate this first chord is at a distance of, let's say, delta A. The earlier delta, this delta is different. Okay. And second chord, what is my second chord? AB line, small a to small b line. Okay. This is my direction of the second chord. Let's say from the initial tangent, the second chord direction is at an inclination of I'll be trying to talk about these notations later as on when it is essential, because I am mixing up many things here which would slightly confuse you. Okay, so earlier I said at the center I'm using the angles as two times that of your delta 1, delta 2, delta 3 and so on, delta n. So why is that? Means whenever you are looking at an arc of a circle, this is from the fundamental principles of your arc of the circle concept. Okay, so from, let's say, a tangent, if you are trying to understand the angle what a chord is making with the tangent drawn to that particular curve, if this delta 1, then subsequently the angle what is getting subtended at the center with respect to that chord what we are looking at, that angle is nothing but it is going to be double that of that so-called delta 1 angle what I have earlier represented. This, we are not doing anything new here. From the simple fundamentals of arc of the circle, we are trying to represent this. So from simple trigonometry, we can go on to derive it and we can get that value at the center, which is getting formed as two times that of delta 1. Okay, so likewise for second chord portion, the angle what is getting subtended is 2 delta 2. For the third chord portion, it is 2 delta 3. For nth chord, the angle what is getting subtended at the center of the arc of the simple curve is 2 delta n. Now this 2 delta 2 is nothing but it is equal to 2 delta 3. It's nothing but equal to 2 delta 4, which is nothing but equal to 2 delta 5, which is nothing but equal to 2 delta n minus 1. Why? Because chord going from A to B, I'm talking about all small notations, small AB, small BC, small CD, small DE, small EF, all those lengths are standard lengths. Okay, they are standard lengths of, let's say, 20 meters chain. If I'm using, it's a standard length of 20 meters what I have from point A to small point A to small A to small B, small B to small C, small C to small D, and so on. Obviously the angle corresponding to that chord at the center what gets subtended is also going to be same, because the chord length is same for all those cases. So angle what is getting subtended with respect to that chord at the center is also going to be same. Then what is different? 2 delta 1 is different and 2 delta n is going to be different. Why? These two are your subchords, and it's not guaranteed that this 2 delta 1 and 2 delta n values has to be same. It totally depends on what is the length of that chord t1 to small a and what is the length of that chord f to small f to t2. So if those lengths are same, then subsequently 2 delta 1 and 2 delta n is going to be same. If those lengths are not same, then accordingly they will be varying. Okay, so let's not worry about it. And whereas all the other chords, which are called as normal chords, whose lengths are same, automatically the angle what gets subtended at the center is also going to be same. Okay, I repeat, it's also going to be same. Right. So now let me quickly go back to all that whatever I was supposed to be understanding from these lines which are indicated. Yeah, so I said after knowing the change of point t1 and t2, then the pegs are fixed at equal intervals on the curve. The interval between pegs is usually 30 meters or one chain length. So in the example, what I was referring to was for 20 meters. So whatever the standard chain that you have used, if it is a 20 meter chain, then your pegs are to be stretched. Not the first chord. The first peg has to be fixed only for the remaining portion of the chain edge length corresponding to your T1. But after your first peg, the second peg, third peg, fourth peg on that arc of that simple curve are to be fixed at that regular interval of your chain length. And the last chord is going to be for some remaining certain length of your chain again to reach your point T2. This distance should actually be marked along the arc, but in practice, it is measured along the chord. As I told you, it's not possible to mark along the arc. Chain or tape cannot be aligned along the arc. So what we do is, in practice, we measure that length along the chord between T1 to small a, or small a to small b, small b to small c, and so on. Assuming that the difference between the chord and the corresponding arc is small and hence negligible. So whether you measure along the arc or whether you measure along your chord, so we assume both are more or less the same. In order that this difference is always small and negligible, the length of that chord what you are supposed to be choosing, the normal chords what you are supposed to be choosing for corresponding standard length, okay, so the length of those chords, normal chords what you are going to be choosing, should be in a way that they should not be having the normal chord length at the standard length of the chain what you are going to be marking, which indicates your normal chord length. So that should not be more than 1/20th of the radius of the curve. I repeat, so your length of that normal chords, whatever you are standardly marking to place your pegs between point A to B, B to C, C to D, and so on. So the length of that normal chord should not be more than 1/20th the time of the radius of that particular curve. In case if the length of that normal chord is more than 1/20th times that of the radius of the curve, then you cannot assume that length of the chord and length of the arc is more or less same. No, you cannot assume that. Okay, so that assumption is said to be valid, or the effect of measuring the length along the arc or measuring the length along the chord is more or less same only when the radius, only when the chord length what you are marking is less than 1/20th times that of the radius of the curve. Understand this point. So accordingly, the curve is then obtained by joining all these pegs, is what we are understanding from the layout. But in the real field, first you should know where is that point A, where is that point B, where is that point C and D, and so on. That is only the challenge. If that points are known, then a simple thing is drawing a rough alignment of line going from point T1 to small a, small a to small b, small b to small c, small c to small d, and so on till your point T2. The distances along the center line of the curve are continuously measured from the point of beginning of the line up to the end. That is nothing but the pegs along the center line of the work should be at equal interval from the beginning of the line up to the end. There should be no break in the regularity of their spacing in passing from the tangent. Tangent means from point T1 to a curve or from a curve to the tangent. So that's up to from point T1 up to your point T2. For this reason, the first peg on the curve is fixed at a distance. So in order to have a proper understanding of what is or how many number of chains or how many number of times the chain is spread to reach to your point T2 or point T1. So that's the reason why we are continuously stretching that chain of known length properly, so that your pegs are also marked on that curve at constant distances, which is equal to the length of your chain. So for this reason, the first peg on the curve is fixed at such a distance from the first tangent point that its chain edge becomes the whole number of the chains. Sir, what is this story? What is this chain edge of point A becomes the whole number of the chains? So if you can recall, I said the chain edge of point E1 was something 152 meters. So 152 meters means how many times I have used my 20 meters chain to spread to go from capital A point till your T1 point? 152 meters means 7 times into 20 meters plus the remaining 12 meters. Okay, so to round it off to a whole number of times the chain is stretched. Okay, so small a point, whatever you are marking on the curve, is marked for the remaining 8 meters, is what I said. So now what becomes the chain edge of point A? Chain edge of point A is equal to chain edge of point T1 plus distance from T1 to small a. Chain edge of point T1 is 152 meters. Distance from T1 to small a is 8 meters. So automatically, what is becoming my chain edge of point A, small a? It is 160 meters. Now, what is 160 meters equal to? 160 is nothing but I have used a chain of 20 meters length. So 20 into 8 number of times I have placed to reach your small a point. So that is what the meaning of this particular statement. So for this reason, the first peg on the curve is fixed at such a distance from the first tangent point T1 that its chain edge means the chain edge of small a point becomes the whole number of chains. So obvious, it has become the whole number of chains. How many number of times the chain is spread to reach your small point A? It is 8 times. Okay, so that is what it is. That is the whole number of peg interval. The length of the first subchord is thus less than the peg interval. As we said, the peg interval is 20 meters, but however, the length of the first subchord and the length of the last subchord is something less than that of your 20 meters. Yes, that discussion also already we had. And that is the reason why we call that first chord and the last chord as your subchords and all the other remaining chords as your normal chords of standard lengths. Yeah, after knowing how that marking of pegs is done, just to have an understanding how the alignment of your curve is going to be. So let us quickly go through your linear methods and then subsequently the angular methods by which you are going to be setting out your curves. So to start with the linear methods. So we have got broadly four different types of linear methods by which we can go on to set out your curves in the field. But however, I'm just talking about how to set out your simple curve based on the linear method. So based on only this approach, we'll be looking at. In case if you are interested, you can go through these particular other linear methods also. How do we set out your simple curves based on offsets from chords produced or successive bisection of arcs or by coordinates or offsets from long chord. So based on these methods, how do we set out the curves if you want to understand? So you have got many number of videos available in YouTube or in your standard textbooks, any of the standard textbooks of advanced surveying, if you look at. So you will be finding that topics available. So those who are interested can go through. So I'll be just taking up this particular first one, that is how the setting of the simple curve is done with the help of offsets from the tangent. So when I'm talking about offsets from the tangent, we are going to be looking at two different types of offsets. One is radial offsets. So with the help of radial offsets, how do we set your simple curve in the field? And with the help of perpendicular offsets, how do we set out your simple curve in the field? That's our main focus with respect to today's class is concerned. So by offsets from the tangent, so how are we going to set out our curves? That is what we are going to be understanding. So we are going to be setting out those offsets to locate the position of your curve in the field based on either radial offsets or based on either perpendicular offsets to that tangent. Okay, so let us start with the radial offsets method. So in the case of the radial offsets method, what is that we are going to be coming across with and how are we going to be setting out our curve in the field? Okay, so first let me say this is my plan, what I am just trying to understand. corresponding to my simple curve, what I am looking at to set out in the field. This is your T2 point. This is my T1 point. This was your point A. Intersection point is B. This is P dash. This angle we said it is phi. So subsequently, this angle at the center is also phi. This line, second, the tangential line is BC line. Yeah. Now what I am going to be doing is from point T1 to B line. What is it indicating me? T1 to B line. It is what we call it as your first tangent. Okay. And B to T2 is nothing but it is my second tangent. Okay. So my first tangent line from point T1. Along this tangential direction, at some distance, let's say x, at some distance x, I am going to be talking about some offset. Now, what is that offset? Look at here. From the center of the arc of the simple curve, I am indicating you what is called as a radial line. What is the radius of this simple curve? Radius of the simple curve is R. It means that, let's say, for example, yeah, I am looking at here. This is point O. This is point T1. And this point is some point P. From the adjacent figure, I am just taking it on. What is this angle here? Angle what is getting subtended between the radial line to that of your tangential line. So that is going to be 90 degrees. So this particular angle, what we see here is nothing but it is, this angle is nothing but it is here. What I have marked is 90 degrees. Okay. Now let's quickly come to this particular slide, to this original picture. So distance from O till T1 is R, which we are calling it as the radius of the curve. And similarly, distance from O till P1, this point, which I am calling it as some point P1. So this distance is also R. Now what I wanted is in this radial direction, going from point O to point P, from the tip of this point P1, at what distance this P point is there in the radial direction? So that distance is what I am writing it as something OX distance. Okay. What does that OX distance refers? Along the tangential length of x meters, I am looking at some radial offset, and that radial offset distance is going to be OX. My objective is to understand what is that OX distance. If I know what is that OX distance, then I can say, okay, now look at here. This is T1 point. This is P dash. Intersection is P. Okay. So at a distance of something X along this tangential length, I am going to have some radial offset. Some radial offset. What is that radial offset value equal to? OX. Now, why is that OX important? At a distance of X in the tangential direction, I have some radial offset which is equal to OX. If I can calculate that OX value, then I can go on to find out the position of this P1, which is going to be on the arc of your simple curve, which you are going to be representing. Likewise, at some distance of X2 along the tangential line, I am going to have some radial offset value, which corresponds to the point P2 on that arc of that simple curve. Like at a distance of something X3 along the tangential line, so I am going to have a radial offset value. If I can find out that radial offset value, okay, I can say, okay, that my radial offset value is something so and so, which is OX3, to give the position of point P3. And likewise, I'll try to calculate your radial offset distances from this tangential line T1 to B or the other tangential line T2 to B. So once we know the radial offset values, then I can figure out the position of those points, and I can join all those points to tell you, okay, this is my simple curve, how I am going to be having it in my field. So in the field, what we are going to do first, we are going to set both those two straight lines. After setting both those two straight lines in the field, Then along the tangential, we go on to find out the point of intersection. From the point of intersection, we go on to figure out the positions of point T1 and T2 on that straight lines. And once the point T1 is known, from point T1 towards your point B, you go on to represent a distance x at which how much is your radial offset value. Our ultimate objective is to calculate what is this OX value, which is going to be a function of x. Okay, so that is ultimately what I am interested in calculating. So for that, I am just looking at here the triangle OT1P. If I am looking at, so I can say my So that's a right angle triangle. So from simple Pythagoras theorem, I can go on to write down that OP square distance is equal to OT1 square distance plus P1 P square distance. Now, what is OT1 square distance is equal to? It is nothing but R square plus T1 P square is nothing but something X square. What is OP square means? OP square is nothing but is what I can write it as OP1 plus P1 to P whole square, because OP is nothing but O to P1 plus P to P1, P1 to P, right? So this O to P1 is once again nothing but it's the radius of your curve. So R plus P1 to P, what is P1 to P is indicated as OX. So this whole square is equal to R square plus X square. So let me come here. R plus OX is nothing but it is under root of R square plus X square. From simple mathematics, I am not doing anything here. So OX is what I am getting it as R square plus X square minus R. So what is that I am getting here? That so-called radial offset distance I can find out given what is the radius of that simple curve and at what tangential distance you are trying to calculate that radial offset. At a tangential distance of 0.5 meter or 1 meter, you if it is at a tangential distance of 0.5 meter, so x is going to 0.5, r value, radius of the simple curve is known, then you can get what is your radial offset value. For x is equal to 1 meter, you can get some radial offset. For x equal to 1.5, you can get some radial offset. Likewise, for different x value, you get different radial offset values, which you are marking from this tangent and from the other tangent. So ultimately, what is that you are locating? You are locating some points which we are getting as your radial offset distances. Once those radial offset distances are known, then this is how your points is what you have figured out. Then I'll be joining those points to indicate me what is called as your arc of your simple curve, which you have set out in the field. Okay, this is by radial offset method. Yeah, so according to the radial offset method, how do we calculate those radial offset values means? So it's nothing but it is equal to under root of R square plus X square minus R. So from this expression, I can go on to calculate your radial offsets. This expression, whatever we are trying to represent here, is very much valid in case if the radius of that particular arc, what you are talking about, is small. In case if the radius of the arc is large, so in such cases, exactly always it might not be possible for us to calculate the values rigorously. So in simple way, we make use of an approximate relation for calculating your radial offset values from the expression x square by 2r. This can also be used for setting out your simple curve in the field based on your radial offset method. But however, it's going to be an approximation curve only what you are setting out there. It's not the accurate curve. If you want to set out accurate curve from this relation, you can go on to calculate your radial offset values, and whatever the curve that you are going to be setting out in the field is going to be the more accurate curve. And the next method by which you can go on to set out is based on your perpendicular offsets to the tangent. The story wise, everything remains the same. Now what we are trying to talk about, along the tangential line, let's say at a distance of something x, I have some perpendicular offset at which I have some point on the arc of that particular simple curve. So let's say that perpendicular offset distance is something Ox, and let's say this point P1 once again from the center, point P1 obviously is going to be there at a radial distance r, because point P1 is supposed to be on the arc of the simple curve. Okay, now what I am just trying to do here is, look at here, my ultimate objective is to calculate that Ox value. What is that Ox value equal to? What is that Ox? Ox is nothing but, which we are calling it as your perpendicular offset. Okay, so P2 P1 distance is what I have marked as Ox, and similarly this P1 to P2 is also nothing but it is equal to Ox. What we have done, from point P1 I have drawn a line P1 P2 which is tangential to your T1 to B line. P1 P2 line is what I have drawn, which is said to be tangential to your T1 B line. Okay, so now let me once again look at this triangle, what I am indicating here, triangle O P2 P1. Okay, so what is this triangle O P2 P1 equal to? From this for this triangle I'll once again apply my Pythagoras theorem. So what is the Pythagoras theorem says? O P1 square is equal to O P2 square, which is adjacent square, plus opposite square. Opposite square is P1 P2 square. Okay, O P1, O to P1 distance is nothing but R, so R square, which is equal to O P2. What is O to P2 distance is equal to? O to P2, from O to P2 distance, I don't know directly. So rather, I am just trying to do here is, I am writing it as distance from point O to T1 minus the distance from point P2 to T1. This gives me what is the distance going from point O till P2 plus P1 P2. Okay, so what is the distance from P1 to P2? So we said distance from P1 to P2 is nothing but it's a tangential line which is drawn to your line T1 to B. So that P1 P2 distance here, what I have is nothing but it is equal to x, because your P1 P2 line is a tangential line drawn for T1 to P point. So length of T1 to P point is x. Obviously P1 to P2, which is a parallel line which has got the same length, which is equal to x. So this is x square. Further implies r square, which is equal to, what is O T1 distance? It's nothing but the radius of the arc minus P2 to T1 distance, which is Ox whole square plus x square. Sorry, here I forgot to mention the x square. So from this, my ultimate objective is to calculate what is Ox. Ox is nothing but, I can write it as, this x square goes on to the left side, so it becomes r square minus x square. Square root of the term goes on to the other side, it is going to be a whole square. If it goes on to the other side, it becomes the square root. And then after rearranging of all those terms, I'll be getting the expression for Ox as like this. So what is Ox indicating me? It is the perpendicular offset value which I am supposed to be setting from that tangential line, when the distance along the tangential line is x, the corresponding perpendicular offset at which the point on your arc of the simple curve would lie is Ox distance. So in the field, what I'll do is, as I know my the direction of my tangential line going from T1 to B, so at different intervals, let's say at some 0.5 meters, I'll understand to calculate what is the perpendicular offset value, that Ox distance for x is equal to some 0.5 meters. Next, at x equal to 1 meter, I'll go on to calculate what is my perpendicular offset. That distance, once I know, I'll mark that point. So for x equal to 1.5 meter, I'll calculate the perpendicular offset value. And accordingly, I'll mark that point on the field, on the ground, I'll be marking that point corresponding to that perpendicular offset, because from that expression, I am calculating the perpendicular offset for different x values, different perpendicular offset values are known. So I'll go on to measure from the tangential line, I'll set perpendicular offsets of that much dimension, and I'll mark those points on the ground. Okay, so once I get the points, assume my points what I have marked are not proper, then I can join a curve like this to get what is your so-called simple curve, which you are ultimately setting out in the field. So with the help of tangent from T1 to B and with the help of the tangent T2 to B, you can go on to calculate different perpendicular offset values, and you can mark those perpendicular offset values on the field to locate various points on the field and join all those points to get what is called as your simple curve, which you are looking at, which you have ultimately set by what is called as your offsets method, which is either offsets which are called as radial offsets to your tangential line, R which is called as your perpendicular offsets to your tangential line. So ultimately you are able to set out your simple curve in the field based on one of the linear method. So likewise, you have got various other linear methods also by which one can go on to set out your simple curve in the field. So the expression for perpendicular offset, which I have already derived. So this is the expression. Roughly, if you want to calculate those perpendicular offsets by approximate way, so still you can go on to calculate from this particular expression and you can set out your simple curve in the field. So this is the typical procedure. Whatever I have talked about is what is indicated. And the next is your angular method by which we are going to be setting out the simple curve in the field. So in this angular methods also, we have got different methods by which we can go on to set out your simple curves in the field based on angular method, or we also call it as instrumental methods. So in these methods, in any of these methods, whatever we are listing here, we are going to be typically using your theodolite with the help of a chain or without the help of a chain, we are going to be setting out your simple curve in the field. Okay, so for today, we'll be stopping our discussion here, and in the next class, we'll be continuing our discussion.